Hi there, I'm David Tanner and this is Homeless World Cup Rewind, a chance to enjoy some great football action from previous Homeless World Cups. We go back 2 years to 2018 and to Mexico City, to the women's final, with Mexico, the holders and the hosts, of course, up against Colombia in their maiden Homeless World Cup. A South American feel to this one, and I'm joined by three top pundits to look at it. The former England winger, Karen Carney. Good to see you, Karen. The former Fulham defender, Terry Angus. And also with us is the former Nottingham Forest striker, Jason Lee. Good to have you all here. Let's get straight to the action then in Mexico City. So the handshake at the beginning of the game. And before we start looking at the match, let's pick who we want to win. Karen, who are you going for?
I'm going to go for the underdogs. I'm going to go for Colombia. And then Mexico are unbeaten, so I'm going to back the underdogs in Colombia.
And Terry Angus, who are you going for?
Well, do you know what? I'm going for Colombia as well, because I've been to a few Homeless World Cups and Mexico rule the roost, men and women. So I'd like to see the underdogs as well, but it would be a tough one for them.
And Jason Lee.
Oh, I've got to change it, haven't I? Everybody's going for Colombia. I'll go for Mexico, just to mix it up a little bit.
I like your style, Jason. Well, Terry, you've been to the Homeless World Cup. What is the experience like? The atmosphere, as we can tell here in Mexico City, is already buzzing.
No, it's a brilliant experience. It's the better experience for the participants. And it's really played in a great spirit. But what you can't forget is the quality of the players.
I remember all Homeless World Cup players have experienced homelessness.
There we go.
In the year leading up to the tournament. And there's the first goal in the final. And it's for Colombia. What a start, you know, that's in the first minute.
The Mexicans, you know, won't be used to being a goal down.
You know what, I'm like, fair play, like, it's really tight and confined, isn't it? You've got to have a lot of skill, close control. I'm surprised at how small it actually looks and feels, do you know what I mean?
Well, when you're there, Karen, it's even tighter when you're there. And the thing is about it as well, there's a set formation, and they stick rigidly to their formations.
It's a bit like futsal, isn't it, really? Obviously, less players and that, but, I mean, I wish I'd done something like this growing up. You know, small-sided. I think technically it'd be really, really good. And I like the rules as well, because obviously one player's got to stay in the opposition half, and they've got to be back. So it's actually like 1v1, and it's quite good.
There's a lot of that. There we go.
It's interesting you mentioned that. I mean, In terms of the skill factor, South Americans, they're brought up in schools. Their school curriculum is futsal. I delivered futsal, so I've got a bit of experience in coaching futsal. But you're right, if English players, if British players, European players spend more time playing futsal, I would like to think technically would be even better than we already are.
But
and Mexico, having been behind or ahead?
Well, I did say Mexico are not bad, to be fair, so yeah, I put a quid on them.
Mexico hadn't lost a game for 3 years until the early stages of this tournament, when they lost two in their debut finals, their opponents today in the final, Colombia.
Colombia.
So Colombia know they can beat the Mexicans.
But I think if I read up, the Colombians went into that game not knowing Mexico's past history.
Ignorance is bliss.
You're not scared.
as you said, Karen, you know, that's this game rules me out. It just rules me out. Too technical.
There's always room for a centre back, Terry.
Not in this game, there ain't.
But there's an aerial view of the stadium. Great crowd, great atmosphere.
Yeah, I was going to say, it must be pretty cool to be playing in that. Like, the atmosphere is pretty.
Thing is as well, Karen, all the games are well supported. So you've got maybe 2-3 pitches going on at the same time. And when Jason and I went, you're flitting from one game to the next, and the passion is unbelievable. But kept with that friendly atmosphere.
Yeah. There we go. I'm surprised watching it. And they don't really get. Do you know what I mean? Like watching that goal there, they kind of like back off a little bit, don't they? They're a bit like nervous to get done by a trick or something like that. Do you know what I mean?
Well, maybe that goes back to what Jason was saying about the futsal.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was the point I was trying to make. Technically, they're very good, very proficient at this, and it's quite fiery as well. It's played at a high tempo. They do lead the foot in as well, and you can imagine when you get caught up against the side of the boards, it's not very friendly at all. But it's a good game, end to end, very exciting. As you can see, lots of goals.
And Mexico go back in front. Oh. Only the goalkeepers are allowed to touch the ball inside those orange penalty areas. If a defender touches the ball within the area, it's a penalty kick. And the attacking players can't go into the opposition box either.
I think we've been, and it's poured down with rain. We went up to Scotland. Yeah, it was pouring down.
Sunny Scotland. And it was a summer. Sunny Scotland in the summer. It was brilliant.
Remind me
that
one
was
time
a test in itself.
The hotel room. Jason booked for that Scotland trip. I'll tell you about that one day.
Oh dear.
Well, the conditions in Mexico City for the 2018 final that we're watching now were very different to the Scottish temperatures. In fact, I can tell you that I, just watching this on a computer screen, have suffered mild sunburn, such as the heat. At the final in 2018.
You've got your factor on, Dave.
I have got factor duffel coat on underneath my shirt.
That's a good save, man. You fancy a business, Karen, then? Is this you?
Yeah, because there's not much running around. So it's short. Save my legs. But I don't know whether I've been technically as good as these. You know, it's, like you said, it's really confined, isn't it? You've got your touch has got to be on point and your movement.
Yeah.
It's fair play to them. Really, you know, I've been really surprised. And given the situation that the girls have been in, and what they would have had to have been homeless within that year that they played in this. It's incredible to see the commitment, the fitness, and the skill, really, given their situation.
You know, and Karen, the players can only participate in one Homeless World Cup. They can only play in one year. It's a new team every year, and yet Mexico's women's team and the men's team are all conquering at the moment, which does perhaps stand up what you were all saying a few moments ago about futsal and the way they learn football in these countries being so effective.
Well, I don't think it's
a half-time whistle.
Sorry, I was going to say, I don't think it's, Jason will probably know more about it. It's no coincidence that the top teams in football have all come from futsal backgrounds and they're all technicians. So, you know, I'm a big advocate of it, and I wish we played more of it in the UK and incorporated it more into our, you know, warm-ups, more futsal base, and then went into our 11 stuff.
You know, looking at this now,
a minute half, 7 minutes in each half. We play two halves of 7 minutes, and there's 1 minute water break at half time here. And I tell you what, Terry Angus, what a fantastic atmosphere there, and the players have certainly delivered in that first half.
They Listen, I've just looked, and as Karen alluded to, there is some high technical ability going on here today. You know, it really is a game of high technical ability and the pace as well. And I'm just thinking now, on the back of this, you know, wouldn't it be good if we can, whatever country you're in, to get the former pros at the end of the finals, we can play against the two winners, the men's and the women's. That would be a really good finale. But the pros would be embarrassed at this stage.
Absolutely.
Well, the second half is underway now with Mexico, the host, and the holders, leading by 3-2 against Colombia. Remember, Colombia beat the Mexicans in the early stages of this tournament. And there is the first attempt and the first goal of the second half. And it's an early hit for the Colombians. Gives the confidence, I would have thought there, Jason.
No, they're playing really well, both sides, to be fair. And as I said, usually it's the South American teams that prevail and get towards the end of every tournament. And what we were talking about earlier, you know, they are brought up from a very, very young age. And, you know, they're lucky if they've even got a football to play with. Let's be honest, you know, we're supporters of the South African teams. And, you know, they lack kit. They lack boots. They lack proper footballs.
Oh, what a strike. But, sorry, Jess. What a strike.
No, great strike. But my point is that their attitude to go and play the game is what shines through. You know, technically they're great, but they've got great attitudes. They want to play, and you know, all sorts of weather, they'd be out there with or without shoes.
I think what we've noticed though with the Homeless World Cup, as well as an organisation, even during the games, this game now will be watched by all the teams, and everybody supports each other through. And we can't forget some of the horrendous backgrounds the league players have come from. And to perform at this level and in the manner in which they perform, it's all credit to them.
Now, Terry and Jason, you both work for the PFA, so you know a thing about equalities and education. How big a factor, how important a tool is the great game of football in helping people better themselves in that type of situation?
Terry, should I go first?
Yeah, Jess. Yeah, please.
Okay. No, I think the great thing about sport, you know, and football in particular, is that you can come from any sort of background and you could, you know, really achieve. You could get to the top of your profession. So, you know, if you show the right attitude and perseverance and, you know, the willingness to work really, really hard, you can do really well. But in terms of education, you know, it gives you opportunities. That's for these people to travel across the world, you know, from, you know, the hot hemispheres to come play in cold climates and vice versa. It's an experience, and football opens up so many experiences for people and gives people a platform also to go and do positive things for other people. So we all love the game of football, but football has a real message, and you know, it's very important in sending out the right messages. You know, we're talking about things at the moment regarding racism and inequality, and football can shine a positive light on these areas.
Well said. I think for me, I could take a football and go 90, 96, 90% places in the world, and you drop that football down and that's the one language. I know it sounds corny, but it is the one language, and that unites people. Sport unites, but football really does unite people. I think what Homeless World Cup has done is amazing, and to take it around the world, it just shows, as Jason alluded to, the equality. We're all about equality, aren't we? And now we've got two teams here, there are countless teams who have played in the tournament who have come together through football. And it is a major, major driver. And we have to ensure that it's open to all.
So we're into the fourth minute now of the second half. 7 minutes, of course, in the second in each half. Karen Carney, did I say Karen Carney MBE until now? I think we should mention MBE, Karen. What do you make of the start to the second half?
Yeah, it's good. The quality has gone up another notch as well. It's the second period, so you've got to really up the ante now if you're going to go on and win it. And fitness as well. Like I said, given the circumstances of these women, I'm so impressed by, you know, technical ability and fitness levels. And I think, like Terry said, you know, you might not have all the resources in the world, but all you need is that one football. And it can just do so much. And to see the level, you never know the situation of people doing that. That was unbelievable. It's just the standard. I'm actually so impressed. And, you know, I'd actually love to go and see it live and feel the atmosphere and the buzz personally. It would be fabulous.
And it's 5-3 to Mexico now. They lost 3-2 to Colombia in the early stages of the tournament. But it's the hosts that are ahead, and they certainly did it in some style there. And what we've all mentioned, the great atmosphere in the arena, and it really cranked up another level with a little bit of skill like that.
The Mexicans. Watch this, Karen. Watch this now. I think it's 2 touches to score.
So it's a penalty kick.
Oh!
So you have 2 touches to score.
Yeah, penalties are not a direct kick. You're allowed to dribble it. You touch it twice before you shoot.
It's just mad how much the game like really replicates so much that I've done in training and like what I would love to be better as an attacking player and, you know, overloads and decision making, yeah. One touch striking, and I'm so surprised at how good it is in terms of the level of quality, and then actually how the game replicates so many things. I've thoroughly enjoyed it so far.
Terry Angus, you'd have been proud of that one.
Listen, I wouldn't have even got there. You know, all they need to do now, the Mexicans, is just see it out for this last final few seconds. You know, nothing silly. Just keep the ball. Like they've done for a lot of the game, really.
It's been a terrific performance today in the final. A terrific tournament for the Mexicans. Can they see it out now?
Just about keeping the ball now. Nothing silly.
The one thing about playing it into the corners in this game is it can very quickly end up straight back up the pitch. But the Mexicans,
you don't want to be chasing the ball into the corner. I'm saying you don't want to be chasing the ball into the corner. It's not one of the favourite places to be. But that's brilliant. Well done, Mexico.
There's the final whistle. And that's what it means to win the Homeless World Cup. The women of Mexico make it 4 in a row. And Karen, well, you were capped 144 times for your country. You scored 32 goals for England. But, I mean, look at that for emotion at the Homeless World Cup.
That's what it means to them, the women there. It's just wonderful, isn't it? And like I said, I literally have got goosebumps. It's the atmosphere, the quality, the standards. And behind all that, no one would know their circumstances. An absolute credit to myself. It's been so enjoyable. Look how much it means to them, that togetherness, and that's what we spoke about. You know, Terry and Jason, that inclusivity and what football does, it brings people together no matter what situation. And, you know, it is literally the best sport, isn't it? So it's wonderful scenes there.
There is like a legacy from these tournaments because the networking, you know, that. They make friends with people from the other side of the world. They keep in touch. Some of them we know with the South African team that we've worked with. Some of them, they go on to become coaches and helpers, and they just want to be involved in some capacity going forward. So it's always, you know, a worthwhile opportunity for them to come together and experience. And for many, just leaving, getting on a plane is that the first time they've ever done that. So when you get to speak to them and you see what they've been through, as you say, to get there and play in this tournament, you know, it's huge. It really does. And for a lot of people, we spoke to people out there, it's changed their lives, literally. it's changed their lives for the better. You know, it's been a positive thing for them, something for them to aim for, and something for them to try and build on.
Well said, Jace. Well said.
Yeah.
So it's four wins in a row for Mexico in the women's version of the Homeless World Cup, and they do it on home soil. And what an atmosphere in Mexico City. Well, incredible scenes there in Zocalo, the main square in Mexico City, famed for that great scene in the Bond film recently, but even better scenes with Mexico women's winning the Homeless World Cup in 2018. Well, what did you make of that then, Karen, in a football sense? 8 goals in it and the Mexicans winning.
Yeah, it was incredible, wasn't it? I thought Mexico deserved the win. Were clinical, showed their experience and why they've won it so many times. Colombia, who we backed, were very, very good, put up a great battle. I think perhaps their inexperience then, you could kind of see maybe the occasion got the better of them, but it was a fantastic game of quality, skill and passion, which is what everyone wants to see.
And Terry, Colombia had beaten the Mexicans earlier in the tournament, so the Mexicans had to show a bit of, should they learn something?
They did, and they showed them good and proper. I think what it was with Colombia was the actual expectation. You know, when they won the first game in the group stages, that was one thing. There was no pressure. I think the pressure of the crowd, the majority of Mexican supporters, I think Colombia just never really got a foothold in the game and come out of the blocks. And Mexico just kept them at arm's length, always a couple of goals ahead. So I think in the long run, Mexico deserved it. They just had that little bit more experience and skill for the game.
And Jason, as we look at these pictures of the teams celebrating, I take it you would agree with what the others said there, that this was one that the Mexicans deserved.
They did deserve it, and expectation is always a hard burden to carry. So to win in front of your home public, home fans, you know, they realised how important it was, and they have to live up to that. And also they've got a history of doing well in the tournament as well. So as much as it's a Homeless World Cup tournament, it just shows how serious they take this. You know, they're technically proficient, they're very professional in their attitude towards the game, and there's a will to win. So, you know, we all talk about friendlies and this, that and the other and having a smile on their face, but Karen and Terry can allude to the fact as well. They know once you cross that white line, you want to kick somebody and you want to win. So picking up that trophy at the end of the tournament would be very gratifying for them.
Well, Karen, let's look back at the goal that put this game out of sight for the Colombians. And it's worth pointing out that Mexico weren't even in possession at the start of this move.
I know, I think that's the vital thing. You see, they don't have the ball, and it's how she wins it back. You'll see coming up now, just uses her strength here, just barges her off. And then it's all about the calmness and the execution, and what a finish that is. And what people don't appreciate is that's on the outside of the right foot. That's not even like that skill to get that power, that accuracy and the precision to use the outside of the foot to get it where it was. And I think that actually mentally deflated Colombia, you know, the quality of the goal, the timing of the goal, you know, and what a goal to score and to clinch it really for Mexico.
Well, a couple of years on from that Homeless World Cup final, we thought it'd be nice to catch up with one of the players and hear about the experience of the whole event. Let's hear from Gisela now, who played that day for Team Colombia.
Hola, mi nombre es Gisela Bolaños. Representé mi país, Colombia, en la Homeless World Cup 2018. Esta fue una de las experiencias más gratificantes en mi vida, la verdad. Que representar a tu país no tiene explicación. Este torneo me dejó muchas experiencias, muchas enseñanzas. Pude conocer otras culturas, conocer otras personas. Es algo que es inolvidable. En este torneo nosotros llegamos a la final, nos enfrentamos contra el local, contra México. Fue una final muy difícil porque México fue un buen rival, pero sin lugar a dudas jugar esta final fue maravilloso. Aunque no pudimos salir campeonas, sí logramos un subcampeonato que fue histórico porque era la primera vez que Colombia participaba en este torneo y nada, fue algo genial y de verdad que viviré agradecida siempre por haberme permitido vivir esta experiencia. Gracias.
Jason, thanks to you. Terry, thanks to you. Karen, thank you very much indeed for your company. Really enjoyed that one. Congratulations to Mexico's ladies team, winners of the Homeless World Cup for the fourth year in a row. Thanks for joining us here on Homeless World Cup Rewind.